So from our next speaker, from a different field and a different generation than Rocio, but still very much a power woman, I feel. She's here to, from a more scientific point of view, tell us a little bit about the relation between men and women. So please welcome Danish psychologist and author Jytte Vikkelsøe.
Does it work? Yes, now it works. I've been traveling all over the world teaching and doing workshops around social injustice and diversity. And I've been asked today to talk about the differences between men and women in the context, thank you, in the context of the Me Too movement. So I named my talk, and I'm going to read this for you. Come Together, the Dynamics of the Sexes and How Culture Created a Divide Our Generation Got a Mend. So when we talk about differences between men and women, it's very important to differentiate between biology and culture. When we talk about biology, we talk about male and female. We talk about sexual differences, and these are universal and can't be changed. When we talk about culture, we talk about cultural definitions of what it means to be feminine or masculine. So we talk about culturally defined roles, and these can be changed significantly. So the Me Too movement is a cultural process of redefining these cultural roles. Oh, was already there. So the biological differences has their root in hormonal differences. For example, the male hormone testosterone, and I don't mean to be crude, so I'll just hide behind Ken Wilber's words when he says testosterone has two drives, and only two drives. It's fuck it or kill it. In other words, it's about reproduction and survival. Testosterone makes you incredibly driven to break limits, to push the envelope, and in the process, bring new discoveries. The female equivalent points to oxytocin, also known as the relationship drug. So oxytocin induces incredibly strong feelings of nurturing and attachment. It's a state of relational being. So oxytocin is all about relating, relating, relating. It's about mothering, and it's about the child's well-being. So these hormones create differences in our value spheres. Testosterone tend towards autonomy and agency. It's about removing obstacles and problems. Oxytocin, on the other hand, tend toward relationship and communion. It's about relational awareness. So men tend to stress autonomy, fear relationships, and must learn to embrace relational being. Women tend to stress relationships, fear autonomy, and must learn autonomy. There it was. to understand our cultural roles, we have to go back to the invention of the plow. There's no single tool in human history that has wreaked as much havoc as the invention, as much havoc between the sexes as the invention of the plow. If we go back to the hunter-gatherer societies, there's a very strong tradition about sharing and equality. Both sexes were invaluable to survival. For example, women gathered up to 80% of the daily food supply. They would come back with information about animal herds, about water holes, and with information about friends and foes. So in that sense, the sexes were financially, sexually, and socially much more equal. But when our ancestors, these nomads, settled to farm the land, two big shifts happened to the equality between men and women. Suddenly there's a surplus of food, meaning there's a capital. So with farming comes ownership, and with ownership comes the need to secure the family possessions for the next generation. We always know who the mother is, less so with the father. That problem was remedied by restricting women's freedom. We now have a sexual double standard. Women have suddenly become possessions. But the subordination of women intensifies further with the invention of the plow. The plow is very heavy. It takes brute force to drive it, and it needs strong, big, heavy animals to pull it. This resulted in a very high rate of miscarriages. And at this point in time, children were not a project. They were a necessity for survival. They were needed in the field. So with the plow, with the invention of the plow, women's labor was suddenly devalued. Women were judged inferior to men, and they had now lost their ancient, honored role as the provider of the evening meal. Men was now the bearer of the family seat, whereas women were only the vassal. The man was the head of the family, he was in charge of the money, and he was supervising work on the farm. This is the rise of patriarchy. And with the rise of patriarchy follows the dominator hierarchy. So let's look at the differences between a dominator hierarchy and a natural hierarchy. A dominator hierarchy is obviously testosterone driven. It's about competition, it's about domination, the winner takes it all. And a dominator hierarchy has a very, very interesting psychology. No matter your position in a dominator hierarchy, you will always have an acute awareness of the privileges of those on the level above you. And you will have an acute awareness about how their position affects your life. You will have much less, if any, awareness about your own privileges compared to those below, and you will hardly know anything about how your position affects those below. So the higher you are in the hierarchy, the more power, the more privileges, the blinder you become to the lack of privileges of others. Why is that? The oxytocin aspect is marginalized in a dominator hierarchy. So what would a hierarchical structure that has the oxytocin aspect implemented look like? Arthur Koestler came up with a structure he called a holarchy. A holarchy is also called a natural hierarchy because it follows the principles of evolution. An evolution has two tenets. It always goes beyond while including what went before. A holarchy is made up of something that's called holons. And a holon has two drives. It needs to be a self-contained whole, meaning it needs to have autonomy and agency. Simultaneously, it needs to be able to be a part of some other whole, meaning it needs to have a relational awareness. So we can say that a holon, so to speak, embodies both the testosterone drive and the oxytocin drive. So let me explain this example. Take the letter A. It is in and of itself a whole. At the same time, it has the ability to be a part of some other whole, a word. So let's take the word cat. A cat is in and of itself a whole. At the same time, it has the ability to be a part of some other more complex whole, like a sentence. The cat was black. That's in and of itself a whole. At the same time, it can be a part of a more complex structure, like a paragraph that again can be a part of a chapter that again can make up a book. But if you take a word out of a sentence, it loses meaning. And it collapses into its lower level components. Now we just have a pile of words. If you take a letter out of a word, it becomes meaningless. And it collapses into its lower level components. Now you just have a heap of letters. So in the same way, if an individual tries to usurp a position in a natural hierarchy, meaning if an individual wants to be a whole only and not simultaneously a part of some other whole, the natural hierarchy will collapse into a dominator hierarchy. Because like with the words and the letters, the complexity of the whole collapses into the lower level organization. If we take a watch apart, we can analyze all the parts of the watch. But what we have now is a pile of parts that can no longer tell us the time. So with the rise of patriarchy, the sexes were divided. Men became wholes only, while women were reduced to parts only. The testosterone drive was centralized, and the oxytocin drive was marginalized. But when testosterone becomes the dominating force in the center, obstacles are overcome rather than related to. And of course, it goes without saying, the testosterone drive is invaluable to survival on this planet. But on its own, without the interplay of its relational counterpart, oxytocin, it is simply destructive. The Me Too movement is marginalized parts reclaiming their wholeness, reclaiming their agency, reclaiming their autonomy, refusing to remain parts only. And we see it all over the world now. Marginalized parts is pushing forth. We saw the enormous women's demonstration in DC and all over the world the day after Trump's inauguration. Trump, who insists on being a whole only. We have Black Lives Matter movement. We have climate marches all over the place. And the youth has finally succeeded in forcing the gun lobby to its knees. The oxytocin awareness is reclaiming its proper place in the global hierarchy. Not to dominate, but to join forces with the testosterone drive. We finally reached a tipping point. The marginalized voices are insisting on being heard. And we got to listen, because they are the ones who knows what is missing at the center. But we are also wise to listen, because today's holes will be tomorrow's parts. Evolution will move on with or without us, breaking new limits while simultaneously include what went before. Thank you.